the lecture I'd like to give tonight bears the title. It's a very awkward title, but I sort of like living with this awkwardness. It's called The Transformative Lecture. And I originally presented this paper in June in Berlin. And I thought of coming back to it on this occasion for a couple of reasons. One is that in a particular part of the paper, I refer to Heidegger, and I refer to some material that we have been visiting this week in the lecture course. And it seemed to me very pertinent in that way. But it seemed to me pertinent in a much stronger sense in that, you know, for me in this new function, but also in the moment we're in, it seems to me very important to try to understand what it is that makes the EGS so special. For me, I've been here, I think, 14, maybe 15 years now. The core of it is teaching, the teaching experience. That is what, for a number of years, saved me as an academic and kept me alive. And I suppose in some sense, I am very, very eager to try to keep what I have so valued alive here. And so to do that, I have to think about what is it that we do? And it's not easy. You know, everyone will agree that EGS is quite magical in many ways. But what exactly makes that magic? You know, I find in my new function, I sometimes have to try to evoke that. You know, in a few words, it's not obvious. It's not obvious. So I start from teaching, my own experience here, and I'm going to talk just a little bit about teaching. And then perhaps if something in my lecture prompts you, we can broaden the discussion. But that's where I'd like to start. And of course, given this topic, this one goes out to Avital. I'm going to speak, this does have a kind of a general pitch at the outset. I'm going to keep it at that level because I'm not just talking about teaching here at EGS, I'm talking about teaching in a broader sense, in the lecture form. And I should add that I'm thinking about my own experience in teaching, which usually does not consist in lectures like this, but rather in lecture series, in other words, in courses. So a lecture for me is usually part of a series of lectures, and it's sustained over a rather significant period of time. So part of what I'm going to be talking about entails an awareness of that temporal factor, or at least maybe the question of what's involved in that temporal factor. So I suppose it is pertinent for this experience this week, six intense meetings. But I'm interested in the way in which the lecture works in time. So, okay, let me start then by saying that I'm interested in this question because I do believe that the lecture has a vital pedagogical function in higher education in general. I presume that the lecture form has an important efficacy in other contexts that is worth considering in itself. And obviously, my unfortunate title cannot but call up all sorts of forms of address which are devoted to personal change that seek to enhance resolve or faith, often for a fee. But my own interest in it derives from my work as an academic, and I want to situate myself in the university in that sense, and my belief that the lecture form is essential for advanced training in at least those fields that draw their sense from the form of language use to which they attend, and their own use of language. I think, first of all, of course, of the humanities. And part of what I want to do is to at least approach the basis of upon which I make this statement. So I'm deeply committed to the lecture form, and this is actually somewhat, I suppose, a marginal position. I mean, I read recently in a description of a Chinese university, they were promoting the liberal arts and, you know, quite purposefully following the North American model, and their English department announced very proudly, we are not going to have lectures. We are not going to oppress our students with any monologues on the part of boring professors, you know. I thought, wow, this is a new step in the liberal arts. But anyway, you know, a lot of people think the lecture is a very problematic form. But I find myself still devoted to it. I feel that it's a responsibility of mine in that way. And I grow increasingly devoted to it as I move toward placing the task of teaching to teach at the very heart of my work in higher education. And I'm referring to a big project that I'm involved in now. And this is after more than three decades of experience. In other words, the more I am involved in this business, the more I am moved toward the question of teaching. But I must also acknowledge from the outset that I have a very provisional understanding of the real basis of the lecture's efficacy. And I have only a limited grasp of what I myself am doing in practicing it. I can see that I know how to do it, more or less. It comes to me week after week, and the results appear to be satisfactory, or so I'm told. But how my lecturing helps to determine the formation of a vocation that I sometimes witness in my students, or the engagement I appear to prompt in some undergraduates, a kind of entry into thinking, and I don't want to exaggerate, it's just a few, but nevertheless, it happens. This escapes me. The fact of this transformation escapes me in significant measure, or my understanding of it escapes me. I know what it is to pose a question and to lead students into it. I know how to link that question, at least some questions, to issues that concern my auditors, and often I know how to bring that concern to the fore, discovering it as I go. I can coach others in this technique, but I cannot say with much certainty why the form of address and the path of speech taken in that unfolding of a problematic induces an attention and a process of reflection that has a transformative effect. And I'm quite at a loss as to what the required duration might be, though I know that time is an essential constituent of what the lecture deploys for its ends. All of which is to say that I can't resist an opportunity like this to try to talk about it, or at least to try to explore it with you. Now, in evoking a transformative effect, I'm thinking first, as I have indicated, of a kind of entry onto a path of learning, be this for professional purposes or for less defined ends, which is the more interesting situation in my experience and is part of what happens here at EGS for many individuals. Teaching, as Heidegger said, is to teach to learn, and I'm thinking first of what we can reasonably or unreasonably seek as teachers on a course of instruction of some kind. But I also follow Heidegger in thinking that this could not be termed a transformation were there not some fundamental shift in the learner's relation to learning and their disposition to learn. In short, a transformation in Stimmung, for example, that is potentially of a profound ethico-political import. Stimmung has been the topic of this week's reading of Heidegger in particular, and it names an attunement or a mood. I assume, and I hope I do more than echo sentimental cinematic representations of the teaching mission, I assume that many of us would not be undertaking the peculiar way of lecturing did we not sense that something more is at stake than the Bildung, civic or professional, of our students. That we take the path of lecturing in our particular fields because they carry us, because this path, excuse me, carries us into a form of engagement with the other, whereby our being in common is at stake. We lecture, as they say in UK, all of us who teach in the university are lecturers, we lecture in order to reach that place of engagement. The odd thing is that we take an extraordinarily indirect path to do so. Indeed, the lecture is not only indirect, and often painfully so, by reason of its suspension of interlocution. It is frequently tedious or deadening in effect. And I apologize now at the end of the week for anything I may have produced along those lines. So why should we imagine that this inherently ambiguous form, which provides shelter for the anxious, the inept, the jaded, or the exhausted professor, why should this form be retained and even cultivated? How could it possibly be transformative in the ethical sense I have evoked? Employing this last term, ethical, I cannot but think of Jacques Rancière's polemics against currents in modern political, aesthetic, and we may assume educational thought, because this is the author of The Ignorant Schoolmaster, after all. Currents that conceive of their social agenda with respect to some transformation in ethos or manner of being. It is difficult for me to resist engaging these polemics. It's really quite difficult. I'd love to go at it. But I really only want to take a cue from Rancière's repeated and rather acerbic attacks on an author to whom he apparently owes a considerable debt, namely Jean-Francois Lyotard. In fact, I would simply like to follow a reference that I might have missed had Rancière not cited it with such insistent irritation. I refer here to an essay entitled The Other's Rights, which unfortunately has not been published in French, to my knowledge, but is well presented in English in the proceedings of a conference sponsored by Amnesty International. The essay dates from somewhere in the early 90s, I believe, maybe 89, but I think the early 90s, and is one of those brilliant occasional pieces by Lyotard that attain almost immediately the level of analysis at which I'd like to take up the question of the ethical political import of the lecture form. So I will use it as a kind of bridge, and I will use Rancière's core objection to it as a kind of entry point. To be brief, and I'll need water for that. To be brief, I would suggest that Rancière's rather violent objection to the argument of the essay is ultimately directed at Lyotard's way of describing the right to speech that lies at the idea of a republic. For Lyotard, this right supposes the duty on the part of each citizen to bring to speech what they bear in the way of a singular debt to something that can never be fully assimilated in any common discourse. Speech in the public space, Lyotard suggests, must bring something other than a recitation of consensus and must be in that respect truly the speech of a human other. It must bear a trait that removes it from immediate common understanding and the forces that demand that immediacy, and recall to us that the equality of citizens of a republic, at least in its ideal form, must be understood from the uncertain grounds of an incommensurability. The human being with rights must be, once again, an other human being, Lyotard insists, like his or her fellow citizens in this very otherness, like his or her fellow citizens in this very otherness. And this citizen is enjoined to bring witness to the fact, to that fact, that they are other and like the others in that respect, in the interlocution that is constitutive of the community's logos. Lyotard makes this point quite effectively in a passage from which Rancière cites with evident exasperation. I quote, "By authorizing every possible speaker to address others, the Republic makes it every speaker's duty to announce to those others what they do not know. It encourages announcements. It instructs. And on the other hand, it forbids that anyone be arbitrarily deprived of speech. It discourages terror. In the way it governs silence in everyone's best interests, authorizing the silence, it governs silence in everyone's best interest, authorizing the silence of discipline and outlawing the silence of despotism." So the idyllic republic evoked here by Lyotard instructs, and I think there is a pun here. I don't have the French. It hasn't been published in French, but I think he's saying instruit. And he's talking about a legal body that is setting up a duty. The idyllic republic evoked here by Lyotard instructs, and it encourages discipline even as it protects. In a sense, it requires discipline because the speech that it legitimates is one that must bring something other to interlocution than a rehearsal of extant socioeconomic relations or a mere confirmation of a demotic community. The republic described by Lyotard does not just defend the free right to speech, that minimal condition to which Rancière holds in his own thought regarding the conditions of a truly democratic politics. It enjoins a form of speech that propagates and perpetuates its very existence as a community of free human beings. To put this succinctly, citizens are enjoined to announce what makes them human, which for Lyotard, who follows Arendt in saying that the human being is worthy of rights only if they are an other human being. The human being is worthy of rights. Citizens are enjoined. I'm going to repeat that sentence. I shouldn't have chopped it. To put this succinctly, citizens are enjoined to announce what makes them human, which for Lyotard is nothing other than their finitude as speaking beings. They're always singular exposure to the limits of what they share of a political space, or, if you will, their precarious belonging to that space. I urge you then to look at those pages. It's on a book called On Human Rights. I urge you to look at these pages because they contain a very rich account of the precariousness of the right to speech itself and what it means to respect that precariousness and the entreaty that is coupled to its every invocation for the fact that any act of speech is exposed to a possible non-reception. But for our purposes today, I want to look more closely at the theme of instruction I have already implicitly foregrounded. Because at the place of instruction identified by Lyotard in the passage I have cited, I recall again, the Republic encourages announcements, it instructs. He places the figure of a master who enjoins silence. The right to speech, he insists, is not a natural right. It entails duty and submission to a process of civilization. I quote here again at a bit more length. Civilization, understood here as the process of learning how to share dialogue with you, requires a moment of silence. Aristotle said, the master speaks and the pupil listens. For that moment, the status of I is forbidden to me. I am assigned the position of you for the master at the tacit pole of destination. Tacit does not imply simply passive. The exaltation of interactivity as a pedagogic principle is pure demagogy. The pupil has the capacity to speak, he has to win the right to speak. To do so, he must be silent. The suspension of interlocution imposes a silence, and that silence is good. It does not undermine the right to speak, it teaches the value of that right. It is the exercise necessary for excellence in speech. Like the pupil, rightists, artists, scholars, and novices must enter into retreat in order to learn what they will have to say to others. The master, whatever his title, exempts his pupils from the sharing of speech in order to tell them something that they do not know. He may even speak to them in a language that they do not understand. The master is not the figure of the general other, of you, but the figure of the other in all his separateness. He is the stranger, the foreigner. How can one dialogue with the foreigner? One would have to learn his language, I'm still citing. This question is in some measure analogous with that of literature and the arts, testifying to something that is present otherwise than as interlocutory expectation, something opaque, Beckett's the unnameable. Still one last paragraph. The silence that the learning process of civilization imposes is the moment of a labor of estrangement. It is a matter of speaking otherwise than is my wont and saying something other than what I know how to say. Through the alterity of the master, the strangeness of another logic is, in silence, imposed. He takes me hostage in order to make me hear and say what I do not know. Emmanuel Lévinas has elaborated this theme better than anyone. And that's at page 142 of the text. I hope that you will already have heard in this passage what prompted me to recall it today. But let me unfold this a little by following Lyotard's suggestion that what the master teaches, this is how I would summarize in some sense, what the master teaches is the use and meaning of language. For a given discipline, of course, but also in the more fundamental sense that he or she practices the enunciation that is required. Again, I don't have the French. I don't know whether he's saying enunciation or it's something that would be closer to an annonce. I'm just going to take the translated version and play with it. So, the master teaches the use and meaning of language for a given discipline, or wherever he or she is speaking, but also in the more fundamental sense that he or she practices the enunciation which he has described to us as required. The master does this, moreover, in an exemplary manner and confronts the student with the exigency of receiving this address and preparing some form of response, itself a form of enunciation, from the ground of the otherness to which they have been exposed by that very reception, an otherness that has become their own. The master, in other words, presents a figure of the other. They become autrui for those who accept his or her teaching and who, at the limit, must eventually become autrui for themselves in the labor of estrangement. You will notice that Lyotard barely evokes the question of authority here, one which Avital is especially accomplished in. Subtle ways. Lyotard barely evokes the question of authority here, which is a particularly tricky aspect of what I have described as Lyotard's gesture of inscribing the master's function in the place opened by the Republic itself, inasmuch as the Republic is said to instruct in the use of speech. The authority the master brings with them prepares the site of teaching, and it must even protect them if they are to appear in the guise of the other The eminent other, of course, is eminently vulnerable and must be received hospitably if they are to teach hospitality. The practice Lyotard describes, which is to prepare the possibility of a free speech, also requires at the same time a shedding or a transmuting of authority. And let me just say, that again is an extremely complicated dimension of what it means to speak in this way and to pass into a different relation, transformative relation. And I want to add in parentheses that this question of authority, I believe, is one of the key issues facing lecturers today as we confront the instrumentalization and bureaucratization of our roles. In the contemporary university, intellectual authority is increasingly replaced by administrative authority. The magisterial function is accordingly undermined. So, again, Lyotard does not really broach the topic of authority on this occasion and simply affirms that, I quote, whatever the master's title, that's his phrase, whatever the master's title, they have the authority to impose silence and to oblige a listening that will have to negotiate the very limits of the intelligible. Immediately through the imposition of a foreign idiom or means of expression, and or more gradually through what Lyotard names the labor of estrangement, a working through that involves the anamnesis that Lyotard describes in his later work. Here, in The Other's Rights, this essay, Lyotard suggests that the master forces his students into a condition of exclusion from speech, an abandonment or a separation that will inevitably recall, or more precisely, call up that distress that attended the first exposure to speech, a condition of abjection that Lyotard, following Freud, sees as constitutive of the human relation to interlocution. In the years in which this lecture was composed, Lyotard would refer to this condition under the name of infancia. I'll quote from his essay one last time. From our native prematurity, our infancy, a mute distress results. It is to this distress that we owe our capacity to question everything around us. But we also owe to it our need to be welcomed, the request that we be authorized to enter the speech community. In interlocution, a drama is played out between me and you. It is the drama of authorization. The question or assertion that we address to others is invariably coupled with an entreaty. Deliver me from my abandonment. Allow me to belong among you. This entreaty allows of a wide variety of modalities, friendship, hatred, love, and even indifference. But in it resides the foundation of the right to speak. For it is this right that assures me that my request will be heard and that I will not be rejected in the abjection of infancia. Yet at the same time, I have to announce to you the opaque otherness that I have experienced and still am experiencing as a child. The law says, thou shalt not kill, which means you shall not refuse to others the role of interlocutor. But the law that forbids the crime of abjection nonetheless evokes its abiding threat or temptation. Interlocution is authorized only by respect for the other, in my words and in yours. That's at page 147. The discipline imposed by the master, therefore, a discipline sanctioned in the Republic, this idyllic Republic, as he puts it, a discipline sanctioned in the Republic both in order to authorize the instruction it requires and the silence of those who assume it, and this silence itself must be protected. In his later work, Lyotard returned to this imperative as he sought to uphold the right to resistance. So that discipline exposes its subject to what Heidegger termed a state of need, which we've been discussing at length this week. From this exposure, we gain the capacity to question, as Lyotard says, everything around us. Being in its totality, Heidegger would have said. Estrangement, in other words, is at the level of world, or, as Rancière would cringe to hear, the ethos. It exposes, at the same time, to the grounds of the interlocutionary relation. Because the solitude or abandonment experienced in this estrangement confronts us with both the need and the right to speak. The need inheres in what Blanchot named the primacy of the human relation, and the right takes its foundation from the institutions of hospitality that protect this relation. If I am denied the right to speak, the wrong I suffer in my abjection is a wrong done to the human community itself. But this foundation of the right to speak, as we have seen, also protects the imperative of allowing into the public space the presence of the other. And it is in the discipline that we have been considering that the capacity to bring this otherness to some form of enunciation or annunciation is cultivated. I've taken a considerable detour by following Lyotard on the topic of the master-student relation and the notion that the master function is to teach the meaning of what it is to speak. But perhaps we are in a position now to consider how the lecture might be part of the instruction we have been considering and to entertain the contribution of another master to this question, namely Heidegger. I note, first of all, that every lecture involves an imposition of silence, and that every lecturer steps into the magisterial function, however much he or she may work to undo the institutionalized traits of that function. The lecture, as I have noted, entails a suspension of interlocution. Questions may be allowed by the authority of the lecturer or his or her host, and conversation may follow in a more or less structured or controlled form, though it is not evident that exchanges following this lecture can actually be named a conversation, since exchange, once again, is allowed by the lecturer or a third party who may prove to be quite authoritarian in manner. Conversation, we might say, happens only outside the space of what is properly termed a lecture. So, for the time of the lecture, and again, this question of temporality is not negligible, the auditor is to submit to what is professed. We all know what suffering may be involved in this discipline, and I repeat that the lecture form allows for quite a bit of abuse through its imposition of silence. I don't want to play that down. But the silence is required if the lecture is to be transformative in the sense I am pursuing. It's required for the sake of another silence. Because in imposing silence, the lecturer is obliging the auditor to listen, and from this obligation, the lecturer is preparing them to hear something in the discourse that exceeds the communicated content. They are to listen to the content of instruction, of course. Hearing will fail very quickly if there is not understanding regarding some topic. But if the lecturer is also seeking to convey the meaning of what it is to speak, then they must prepare their auditor to attend to that otherness to which Lyotard referred. As Lyotard pointed out, this otherness could present itself in so radical a form as to appear as a foreign idiom. And I might note that in these years, Lyotard found himself obliged on some occasions anyway to try to defend what was going on in the French context against a rather concerted and hostile attempt to actually to silence the excesses that were perceived as emanating from Paris in particular. The French discourse was a matter of considerable controversy. So, as Lyotard pointed out, and I repeat my sentence, this otherness could present itself in so radical a form as to appear as a foreign idiom. But the master Lyotard describes does not introduce a foreignness or estrangement into this speech in order to oblige a simple task of translation, whereby the student would bring the foreignness or idiosyncratic nature of their teacher's discourse to a commonly accepted meaning. Nor is it a matter for the student of mastering a foreign language, be this the jargon of some theory. Rather, it is a matter, once again, of teaching the student to attend to something in this language that exceeds the propositional or signified content of that language. Following Lyotard's argument, but drawing a bit more strongly on the Heideggerian strain that runs through it, we might say that this excess is the human share of discourse, something that Lyotard would sometimes name the inhuman in relation to the assumptions of modern humanism. Heidegger sought to describe this discursive element in the lectures of the later years of his elaboration of the existential analytic, I mean the late 1920s, when he sought to convey to his auditors that the philosophical concept is elaborated from the place and in the time of the thinker's questioning, in short, from the Dasein, a very particular Dasein. That place was nothing other than the midst of beings in their totality, revealed initially to the questioning thinker in some form of Stimmung. Gripped by this Stimmung, the questioning philosopher, whose task in fundamental ontology is to think the constitution of the Dasein in its place and time, will elaborate concepts that will always only be indicative of the dimensions of existence they seek to articulate. and they will only find their meaning in relation to one another, each of these terms that indicate something of the existence of the Dasein. They can only be thought in their relation, and each of them in that relation is indicative of something that they cannot say as a concept. Their meaning will thus inhere in the way they point back while pointing forward to what the auditor must assume of their own being if they are to follow the questioning. In other words, the auditor must be engaged in what they are hearing and must listen from their own experience of being in the world. So I repeat that sentence just for clarity. Their meaning will thus inhere these concepts in the way they point back while pointing forward to what the auditor must assume of their own being if they are to follow the questioning. Heidegger will therefore insist repeatedly that this auditor must learn to avoid translating the concepts of philosophy into descriptions of something that would be present at hand, which is, of course, what happens every time a commentator seeks to explain a Heideggerian motif with reference to everyday experience, which we see more and more often in the secondary literature. The philosophical lecture offers only a semblance of representation, he says, all along acknowledging that this dimension of representation and the ambiguity it introduces is unavoidable. To bemoan the last fact, he says, I was just telling Avital about this, to bemoan the last fact, he says, in the Fundamental Concepts of Metaphysics, a lecture series from 1929-30, is like complaining at the sight of a pile of manure in an otherwise handsome farmstead. The dross of representation is an essential part of the activity. And I'll let you play with this pungent metaphor yourselves. And if I start sniffing, you might realize that something has gone wrong with this lecture. But if we are to get to what is actually said in the philosophical lecture, he tells us we must learn to hear from our Dasein. What philosophy deals with, Heidegger declares, I'm quoting, only discloses itself at all within and from out of a transformation of the human Dasein. I'll say this again. He says this several times, but this one's in italics. What philosophy deals with only discloses itself at all within and from out of a transformation of human Dasein. I invite you to read paragraph 70 of the Fundamental Concepts, which developed this argument at considerable length. But Heidegger states there that to follow the indication of the philosophical concept, I quote again, our understanding must first twist free from our ordinary conceptions of beings and properly transform itself into the Dasein in us, end quote. The challenge to such a transformation, he says, lies within each of those concepts, death, resolute disclosedness, history, existence, yet not as some additional so-called ethical application of what is conceptualized, but rather as a prior opening up of the dimension of what is to be comprehended. So I repeat again just for your clarity. The challenge to such transformation lies within each of these concepts, not as some additional ethical application of what is to be conceptualized, but rather as a prior opening up of the dimension of what is to be comprehended. To begin to hear, in other words, we must have been made attentive to something that the concepts themselves can only point to with their challenge. We must have already heard in some way, and that we will have to appropriate genuinely and concretely as our own. A silent call must be speaking in the text of philosophy, and it must be heard if this appropriation is to occur. Many of you will be familiar with the line of argument Heidegger pursues here and will be familiar with some of the rhetorical strategies that Heidegger employs in an effort to project in his lectures and writings the essential structure of the Dasein in its historicity. Being in time, Sein und Zeit, is offered to us from the ground of an authentic assumption of that structure, or at least supposedly. It is a projection of the existence of the Dasein, not just a description of it. It thus speaks to us from the place structurally assigned to the voice of conscience and as a discourse that is to assign us to our freedom, even as it describes that freedom. This is why Sein und Zeit is indeed the masterwork of the Marburg period, though every one of Heidegger's lectures performs in some manner this act of instruction. And Heidegger's readers will recognize that a comparable concern informs Heidegger's writings and lectures throughout his career. The passages I read to you were from 1930. In 1942, in the lectures on Hölderlin's poem Der Easter, Heidegger paused to comment on a particularly Heideggerian phrase by saying that its opacity was designed to signal an enigma. I quote, something concealed that we care about in giving counsel or instructing. And he added, I quote, we are excluded from comprehending such statements so long as the appropriation of an essential transformation in our essence has not occurred. It's a very forbidding and authoritative and in some way arrogant statement, but at the same time, it's saying exactly what he said throughout the 20s and 30s and saying, you cannot understand what I'm saying except from the ground of what I'm talking about, which is the structure of the Dasein. And in that respect, he is accepting that a great deal of his writing is going to be opaque. And he's also accepting, as he goes on to say in that passage, we ourselves won't understand this all the time. We will read, you know, some of us will be working at this for 30 years and more and come across a Heideggerian paragraph we think we should surely understand, and suddenly it's gone. It's not there. And it's a rather curious aspect of reading Heidegger and text of that kind. Sometimes we just can't understand. I experience that all the time. Some of you have seen it this week. So again, I quote, we are excluded from comprehending such statements so long as the appropriation of an essential transformation in our essence has not occurred. And readers of a later lecture series, such as What is Called Thinking, will be familiar with Heidegger's effort to thematize what it means to lead into the peculiar distress and impulsion that he draws from the phrase, what is most thought-provoking in our age is the fact that we are not yet thinking. The master's gestures evolved as the years proceeded, but Heidegger was always attempting a transformative lecture. But when the one lecture series is particularly interesting for me in this regard, it's the one that I've been reading this week with, here, and this is the lecture series of 1934-35 in which Heidegger first presents Hölderlin's river poems via readings of Germania and Der Rhein. Here, the effort is to call the auditor to a transformation in their relation to the poet's language as a condition of a transformation in their relation to their own historical destiny. Calling attention to his own silences in this presentation and the fact that his own lecture is no more immediately understandable than Hölderlin's Dichtung, Heidegger urges the auditor and the reader to move from a surface reading of the poetic verses before them to a reading of the poetizing, the Dichtung, that is veiled by them, and to transform thereby their relation to poetic language. Only such a transformation would give access to what we must properly read in that Dichtung, which is the poet's relation to the source of his poetry, which Heidegger calls the metaphysical site of the poetry, and to language itself. The articulation of that relation is a kind of silent, rhythmic gathering that Heidegger names the Schwingungsgefüge of the poetic saying. I've been concentrating on that at some length in the last couple of days. Let's just say the structure of the articulation of the resonance or reverberation of the poetic saying. Structuring the poet's own fundamental Stimmung and all verbal composition in the poem, this rhythmic order makes the poetic language indicative in its own singular manner, just as Heidegger was saying of philosophical concepts. It gives this structure, it gives the poetry its pointing or beckoning character, its hinting character. And that to which it silently points is what this poem both veils and reveals of the poet's metaphysical sight, as Heidegger refers to it. It is from this position, of course, that Heidegger addresses his true auditors, the German ones, that is to say, and claims that this poetry and the sight it brings to language in its saying fundamentally concerns them. I needn't dwell on the implications of this last step in Heidegger's lecture course, even though its preparation throughout the lecture series is quite fascinating for what it tells us about Heidegger's thinking at this point about the notion of Mitsein. But I do want to focus on one point where this step makes itself manifest in a particularly intriguing way. Now, I recognize that I have moved very quickly in evoking the transformative moment or movement that Heidegger seeks to effect in bringing us to hear in Hölderlin's poetry the composed Stimmung from which it is written, what Heidegger calls the Grundstimmung, the fundamental attunement from which the poet is writing. Heidegger's argument is that it is only in as much as we are exposed to this attunement that we will undergo a true transformation in our own existence, because it is only Stimmung that touches and affects Stimmung. We, as readers and auditors, are to be brought into the Grundstimmung of the poetry and thereby undergo both the distress or the need from which the poetry was written in its destitute time, and at the same time know the opening that this poetry affects. We are to undergo an experience with the poetic language. But Heidegger insists at this point that it is not enough simply to read along with him. His Vorlesungen are not designed to stimulate a mere Mitlesen. I'll read this in German for your amusement. I want to say pleasure, but my accent is such that I'm afraid it sounds slightly amusing. But I think it's quite a striking sentence. Es handelt sich ja nicht darum, Sie oder Einzelne zu überreden, hier etwa in dieser Vorlesung willig mitzulesen, sondern es steht zur Entscheidung des das Mitfragen der Frage, wer wir sind, ob wir ein Gespräch sind oder nur noch ein Gerede, ob wir uns auf die ursprüngliche Geschichtlichkeit unseres geschichtlichen Daseins einlassen oder und drumherum drücken. I'll give the English as it has been translated by Will McNeil and Julia Ireland. It's not a matter of persuading you or certain individuals to willingly read along here in this lecture, for instance. Rather, what has to be decided is an engagement in asking the question of who we are, whether we are a dialogue or just some idle talk, whether we let ourselves enter into the originary historicality of our historical Dasein or merely hang around on the periphery. His lectures, are not designed to stimulate a mere reading with, mitlesen. Rather, they challenge the auditor to undertake a decision regarding their being with the one who is lecturing. I think it goes without saying that the figure of the master that emerges here is not the one Lyotard had in mind. But Heidegger has given us a rather intriguing way of characterizing the divergence. At least it is intriguing for me because the transformative effect I seek in the Vorlesung, which is very close to what Lyotard described in his essay, derives from nothing other than an attempt to induce or provoke a mitlesen. Again, I speak to you principally in my role as a professor of literature and philosophy, though I hate being too disciplinary in that distinction, but still, that's where I teach. I speak from my place in the humanities. I concur with Heidegger that this mitlesen cannot be a participation in the mode of a simple as if, a mere entertaining of the experience presented in the text, be this a poetic or artistic experience or an experience of thought. A mitlesen must entail an engagement with the language that partakes in some way. But the latter engagement occurs whenever we undergo an experience with language that is other in the sense indicated by Lyotard, because this encounter, if we submit to it, as is required in the form of the Vorlesung, provokes what Lyotard termed a labor of estrangement from which we must find the possibility of speaking in our turn. Let me return to Lyotard's description of the master function, which I'll cite one more time, and I've already cited part of this. The master, whatever his title, exempts his pupils from the sharing of speech in order to tell them something that they do not know. He may even speak to them in a language that they do not understand. The master is not the figure of the general other, of you, but the figure of the other in all its separateness. He is the stranger, the foreigner. How can one dialogue with the foreigner? One would have to learn his language. This question is in some measure analogous with that of literature and the arts, testifying to something that is present otherwise than as interlocutory expectation, something opaque, Beckett's The Unnameable. So following from this, it would appear to me that whenever a lecture involves literature and the arts, or the text of thought, wherever it occurs, and presuming it really engages these discourses, rather than merely sketching historical context or lingering in their representations, then we are potentially dealing with something more than an analogy between the position of the master who becomes autrui for the auditor and that occupied by the opacity of a text, which it is the master's role to offer and explore. In short, to read. Moreover, when Vorlesung becomes Mitlesung, the master, if they are faithful to the task of reading, must present a kind of dispossession before the text. Lyotard will name this a dénouement. Bringing the text to speak as other and teaching this act of reading, they must teach, the master must teach, their own dispossession before the text. and must constantly reclaim this disposition, perform this disposition in relation to this text that they are seeking to offer. This is why the master in the field of literature or philosophy will at once shed and instantly reclaim their authority as they begin to admit that they have nothing to teach beyond the meaning of reading and speaking, which can never be properly said, only indicated. And don't ask me to judge you, they will add. But I do believe, and I'm going to come to a sudden conclusion, which may prompt questions of their own, which I would invite. I do believe that the master who practices the transformative lecture, and perhaps some of the ways I've indicated, must be ready to respond to what emerges in the space of the teaching relation from the other side, so to speak, and must be prepared to draw forth the difference of the partage, the partaking, that occurs in that space. And that space may span the time of a lecture or unfold over a longer and much more indefinite time. The most difficult task in mastering the lecture form, it seems to me, is in learning to hear the other to whom one is lecturing. And every lecture must involve such hearing, whether or not the response comes immediately. In other words, every lecture that is effective in the manner I have sought to describe will provoke a transformation in the lecturer as well as the auditor. And this, I suspect, is why many of us remain here to lecture. Thank you.